Well, good morning, Walnut Village. I hope you're all doing well. I know the staff is working really hard to keep you well, to keep you engaged, to keep you protected. I'm so grateful for Walnut Village and what it does for each of you. Well, I don't know if you can tell, but I'm speaking to you today from a clothes closet. You may have noticed that each week when I do these videos, I try to move around at different locations with different backgrounds. And at this point, hopefully you're asking, why is he in a clothes closet? Is he in trouble with his wife? Has she finally had too much of him and he's getting on her nerves? Is he hiding from the dog? What gives? Well, rest assured, it's none of the above. Or at least, I don't think any of these reasons are a possibility. I've not asked Terry or the dog lately. I know what the background looks like, and I chose this space intentionally. I'm starting this video in the clothes closet because I think it may represent what you might be feeling. Maybe you're feeling confined or you're feeling stuck. It's a small space. Maybe your apartment feels like it's closing in on you. Well, we'll come back and talk about this more, but that's why I'm talking in a clothes closet this morning. But let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Lord, continue to bless Walnut Village and its residents. Protect them, keep them safe, help them endure, and give them strength. Give them health, keep them from fear. Bless each one of them. And this morning, in these moments together, let us truly worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, for true worship to occur, you know what I'm going to say. We need to be sure there are no breaks in our connection to God. Breaks created in our lives by sin. So we always begin with confession and then receive forgiveness. Any connection that's broken can be restored just by a word of prayer. So this morning, let's pray together. Dear God, help us live a life worthy of you, pleasing in every way. Let us grow in your knowledge, become strong with your power. Give us great endurance and patience, joyful and thankful hearts. Point out those attitudes, those actions that anger you or make you sad. Keep our consciences pliable and convict us of wrong. We ask your forgiveness and seek your strength to change and to avoid a repeat of these sins, of which we are now cleansed. Amen. Let's take a moment of silent and personal confession. Amen. Well, it does us no good if we don't acknowledge a gift when we receive it. We need to rely on the grace given us, and so we make this statement of our acceptance together. Again, pray with me. God, there can be nothing sweeter than restoration with one we love. We thank you for the grace and forgiveness you give us each time we ask with humility. Amen. Our scripture this morning is going to be easy for you to remember. It's out of 2 Timothy and it's out of Colossians. And in both cases, it's chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. But let's start with 2 Timothy. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us what to do that is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. And that's you, and that's me. And then our Colossians passage, it says this: Let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all wisdom he gives. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. We love to unite. We love the fact that as a church, we have common beliefs that we can rally around. So let us say the Apostles' Creed together. We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge those both alive and dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Well, while the music is playing that I'm going to put on in a moment, let's do as we often do. Let's pass the peace. If you're able, go to your balcony, go to your patio, and the statement that you can say to your friends and neighbors is this: the peace of Christ be with you. Stay well. Okay, let's do this. Alexa, play "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God."
Here's "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God" album version by Chris Rice on Amazon Music.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils fills should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever.
Okay, we're back. Well, our scripture from the Old Testament today, then, is from Daniel, chapter 4, verses 34 and 35. And this is King Nebuchadnezzar's praise to God after Daniel, the prophet, tells him a dream that he's had and interprets that dream for the king. This actually is a song of the universe. It's a praise that every created being recognizes deep in their soul. In fact, Handel expressed it in his masterpiece, and the phrase that he highlighted is, "And he shall reign forever and ever." So let's read this two verses from Daniel 4. The king said, "I praised and worshiped the Most High, and I honored the one who lives forever. His rule is everlasting and his kingdom is eternal. All the people of the earth are nothing compared to him. He does as he pleases among the angels of heaven and among the people of the earth. No one can stop him or say to him, 'What do you mean by doing these things?'" We serve a powerful God, a wonderful God, who's able to conquer anything, even this COVID-19. Well, pray with me just for a moment as we begin our teaching time. Gracious God, may you bless these people that hear this message. May the words of my mouth be acceptable, and all of our thoughts also be acceptable to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, back to that question again. Why video in the clothes closet? I chose it because perhaps it symbolizes what you may be feeling right now. Trapped, stymied in doing what you want to do. Forced in unwanted confinement. Being stuck, walls closing in on you. Maybe this causes feelings of frustration, isolation, worry, and even fear. Maybe, like so many who are sheltering in place, you feel like screaming, "I gotta get out of this place." Or maybe, "When will this ever end?" Absent is that comfort that comes from freedom of movement and in-person warmth that we receive from friends and family in normal times. And as an aside, maybe we need to just remember it when this is all over and give thanks for freedom of movement and in-person warmth that we receive from friends and family that right now we're deprived of. Well, do you agree? Or are you thinking, "Well, I really don't know. I've had none of those feelings. What's he talking about? I mean, I have it pretty good. I have meal delivery, staff checking on my health. I have them screening everyone so I am well protected. But now that he mentions it, maybe I should be fearful, frustrated, worried, and upset. Thanks a lot, Chaplain. What's the point of this video anyway?" Well, I know everywhere we turn, there is a phone call, there is a letter, a memo, Zoom, or FaceTime message. There's internet helps, all designed to cheer and to encourage. And maybe you think this video message is just more of the same. Maybe it is all just too overwhelming to help. Well, listen, I don't want to give you a bunch of negatives that never even occurred to you. I mean, a focus on negatives never helps anything or anyone, does it? Certainly, if we just take a step back and consider the other 7.6 billion people with whom we share this planet, we may get more perspective. Maybe we should think about what situations others face. No shelter, no food, poor health. No health, no health care, no family, no friends. The reality of other situations may make ours look pretty good. But is it enough to simply focus on the plight of others? Is that what we are supposed to do? Are we just to think on their depressing situations and in some weird way snap ourselves out of our negative emotions? Can the answer be to think, "I don't have it so bad. Compared to so many others, I'm actually really blessed in my circumstance"? Is that what we're going to do? Is that the help? Well, that's a true statement, and it is good to do. But we should not forget it. We all know that to dispel the negative, a focus on the positive can be really helpful. I will tell you that I firmly believe in the old church chorus that says, "Count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done." Reorienting our thinking in this way is a great start to improving our emotional state. But is it enough? You have heard, you can't change your circumstances, but you can change your attitude. Is that the right answer? Is that all we have to do? It's good. Remember it. But is that the answer? If we do this, will we be able to say, all is well, all is right with the world? Maybe in the short term, the immediate. But as difficulties drag on, what then? We are left with a question. What are we to do? What we need is perspective, a truth, a comfort that will last, that fits in any crisis. So let me remind you of the words of Jesus, which we read in Matthew 24. Heaven and earth will die, pass away, but my words will never pass away. The Bible is permanent, its wisdom for always, and its words are for us and for every circumstance. It is truth, again, it is wisdom and comfort. It's filled with promises, if you look at it, for our good, made by God Himself. It is for the long term. What we learn from its stories, historical accounts, and teachings give us the answer to what are we to do. Let's look at how that answer to what are we to do came to the prophet Elisha in the Old Testament. Listen as I read for you that story that comes from 2 Kings chapter 6. When the king of Aram was at war with Israel, he would confer with his officers and say, "We will mobilize our forces and we will go to this place or that place and we will do harm to Israel." But immediately, Elisha, the man of God, would come forward and warn the king of Israel about what the king of Aram was planning. "Do not go near that place," Elisha said, "for the Arameans are planning to mobilize their troops there." So the king of Israel would send word to the place indicated by the man of God. Time and time again, Elisha warned the king of Israel so that he would be on the alert and avoid destruction. The king, as you can well imagine, of Aram, became very upset over this. He called his officers together and demanded, "Which of you is the traitor? Who has been informing the king of Israel of my plans?" "It is not us, my lord and king," one of the officers replied. "Elisha, the prophet in Israel, this man of God, tells the king of Israel even the words you speak in the privacy of your bedroom." The king replied, "Go out and find out where he is, so I can send troops and seize him." And then the report came back to the king of Aram, "Elisha is at Dothan." So one night, the king of Aram sent a great army with many chariots and horses to surround the city. When the servant of the man of God got up early the next morning and went outside, there were troops, horses, and chariots everywhere. "Oh, sir, what are we to do?" the servant asked Elisha. "Don't be afraid," Elisha told him, "for there are more on our side than on theirs." Then Elisha prayed, "O Lord, open my servant's eyes and let him see." The Lord opened the young man's eyes, and when he looked up, he saw that the hillsides around Elisha and the city and the enemy was filled with horses and chariots of fire. Interesting story, no? What does this story tell us? The prophet Elisha is a wanted man. He is trapped. He is stuck. And it is more than a clothes closet that confines him. His situation is fraught with danger. He can't get out of the city. He is surrounded on all sides. The city seems so small and confining to him under these circumstances. The city is in a lockdown, and there is no escape. His future does not look good. I'm sure that simply focusing on how bad others have it, would have not helped Elisha or his servant's disposition. However, there was in Elisha a spirit of calm, and when everything around him was in chaos or in danger or restrictive, he had this calm. And what about his servant? We read that he gets up in the morning, and before he even has his Starbucks coffee or his Egg McMuffin, he sees trouble all around him. He panics as he sees armed soldiers, horses, chariots ringing the city. It was such a shocking surprise to him. He feels fear in every part of his body as he likely knows what's ahead. He knows that all the city dwellers would suffer the wrath and severe punishment, if not death, for harboring Elisha, the enemy of the king of Aram. And so his fear was very real, and no amount of positive thinking was going to dispel his worry and his fear. So he runs to Elijah and he tells him what he sees. And now, just like our government leaders at all levels, our corporate leaders, just like our pastors or me as your chaplain, we tell people, don't be afraid. We'll get through this. Well, is that what occurred? Is that the end of the story? Well, not exactly. It is normal in a crisis to give reassurances. We need that. But our leaders, you and I, as much as we want to hear reassurances or give reassurances, we don't always have the answers to the crisis. But Elisha does. He says, don't be afraid, for there are more on our side than on theirs. What a strange thing to say. Was it enough just to give this reassurance? Did the servant understand immediately, feel confident and sure of a positive outcome? Was the reassurance enough and the end of our story? Not by a long shot. Elisha had to follow up with prayer. And then there came the answer that was needed. Proof of the statement, there are more on our side than theirs. As Elisha prayed, God opened up the servant's eyes to see what Elisha saw. Fiery hosts, the heaven's armies ringing the enemy army, ready to fight the battle and protect Elisha, his servant, and all the inhabitants of Dothan. In our story and in our life, fear is dispelled by prayers offered and answered. Fear is disowned by faith. Fear is displaced by miracles. Fear dispensed with answers from the Word of God. This is what God promises. This is what God does. God does not offer up platitudes to deaden our fear temporarily. No, God decimates fear, eradicates it once and for all. How many times do we read about figures in the Bible and their encounters with God or his angels and prophets? And what do they typically say? Do not fear. Fear damages our health. Fear damages our relationships. Fear keeps us from doing things we are designed to do for fear of looking foolish. Fear traps us just as surely as Elisha was trapped. And fear is a self-made prison. The prison doors are open, and it's our choice to walk out from the prison that fear has created. Do not fear. What is the strongest force in the universe that no one or nothing can escape? Some may say death, but God conquered death. Let me tell you, I don't fear COVID-19 or death, but honestly, in weak moments, I fear the results of the virus, the ramifications of the virus on the economy, on my family, on friends, on institutions, on relationships, on life as we used to know it. And I ask, how long can this go on? When is this going to be over? And I ask that timeless question that Elisha's servant asked, what are we to do? But in weakness, our weakness, God always shows strength, his strength. So go ahead, build your list of fears. Write down every what if this happens that you can think of. But don't worry about them or dwell on them. Give them to God. Turn that list of what if this happens over to God. Let his fiery armies defeat any fear, any what if you may have on your list. We need to give our fears to God. We need to pray. We need to search the Bible for promises of good, and we need to remember them and grab hold of them, because there is a sobering reality to all of our negative circumstances, and it is this. Because of sin, this world is broken, not functioning the way God intended. Because of that, COVID-19 may rebound, come back again. And if not COVID-19 threatening us, then some other calamity. Jesus wanted us to know that. And what he said to his disciples and to us down through the centuries is that we would have tribulation. And he didn't want us to be surprised, or he certainly didn't want us to be fearful. He told us, in this world, in this life, you will surely face tribulation, hardship of every kind, but do not fear. Do not be discouraged, for I have overcome the world. In my strength, you have nothing to fear. There is nothing that can beat you. That's a promise, rock solid, from the God of the universe, made to you, made to me. Do not fear, even though tribulation is upon us or will come. Psalm 46 was written during the reign of Israel's King Jehoshaphat. That's not jumping Jehoshaphat, that's King Jehoshaphat of Israel. And a vast army of his enemies was surrounding his countries, and they were allied together, and they marched against Israel. Of course, King Jehoshaphat was terrified by this specter of destruction and begged God for guidance. He asked the question, what are we to do? He heard from God, do not fear, and he instructed the people to sing praises to God as his outmanned army walked out to meet the enemy. He was given reassurances by God. He responded in psalms of praise and singing. And at that very moment, when his outmanned army was walking out, the people began to sing and sing some more and give praise to God for all of God's provision for them. And what happened? God caused Israel's enemy armies to start fighting among themselves. The enemies of Israel began attacking each other. When the army of Israel arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw were dead bodies lying on the ground as far as they could see. Not a single one of the enemy escaped. God arose as Israel's strength and as their help with supernatural intervention in a time of trouble. Do not fear. The answer to the question, what are we to do? Leave it to God. He answered the prayer. He defeated both their external enemies as well as their internal enemy, fear. Martin Luther wrote his famous hymn, which if you were paying attention during Passing of the Peace, you might have recognized, A Mighty Fortress. And it is based on this psalm that we just read, Psalm 46. Let me close by reading portions of this great psalm of promise and hope that is for all generations of those who put their complete faith in God. And it answers the question of what are we to do every time it is asked. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength and an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with surging, do not fear. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. God lifts his voice, the earth melts away. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done. He has brought on the earth peace. He makes wars cease. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Israel is our fortress. Do not fear. The question will continue to be asked time and time again, what are we to do? And the answer forever will be, let God be your fortress of security, protecting you from every fear. Do not fear. Amen. Each week we pray together the Lord's Prayer. A pastor suggested to me that each morning before my feet hit the floor, and while I'm still in bed, that I pray the Lord's Prayer. We all know it. It's easy to do. As a prayer, it has all the elements of communication with God that we need. It provides comfort, it provides wisdom, confession, and it helps us eliminate fear. So let's pray it together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as we close, let me give you this blessing. May you fully trust the God whose rule is everlasting and whose kingdom will never end. May you remember that no one can stop him. May you understand that among all the people of the earth and among angels in heaven, no one can compare or stand against him, as he does as he pleases. And what pleases him is to always do what is best for us, his children. And now, may you always hear his answers to your questions of, what are we to do now? Do not fear. Amen. Well, this is Chaplain Steve. Until next time, have a great day, a great week, and remember, do not fear.